In the past, we've had some exciting conversations revolving around essential contexts, like the future of design and education post-COVID-19 with Basia, while Ashwin Sanghi and Rajiv Masand showed us how to drive creative careers towards commercial success. Bobby Brown spilled her magic about what it takes to make it big. And last week rounded off with Mr. Vitor Aguiar addressing the journey of a creative mind. So today we add yet another flavor to our exclusive interactions. To take it ahead, I will request my colleague and head of department, School of Contemporary Media, Ms. Meha Jaiswal, to introduce you to our guest of the day. So Meha, over to you. And we are very excited for this new interaction to come our way. And I'm sure the joy that we have bringing these conversations to the students, I'm hoping that they are enjoying it with the same enthusiasm. So over to you, Meha.
Thank you so much, Deepti. Thank you, friends, colleagues, and my dear students. I have the pleasure and privilege to present to you today a true icon of cultural amalgamation. A young Japanese girl who came to India 24 years back when she was all of 20 herself, who made India her home away from home. She sacrificed an easygoing, very tech-dominated life for her passion and love for the Indian dance form. The lady who has spent more years in India than her own country of origin. Friends and students, it is an honor for me to present to you an inspirational story of how passion and perseverance could push you to write your own success story. Mm-hmm. Friends, please welcome Masako Ono-san. Can we have the video, please?
Yes, sure.
Konnichiwa to you, Masako-san.
Konnichiwa, Masako-san.
Konnichiwa. Namaskar. Mera naam Masako Ono hai. Mujhe India mein 26 saal ho gaya hai. Main ek Orissi dancer hoon. Aaj main bahut khush hoon Pearl Academy webinar ko attend karte hue.
Thank you, Masako-san. Thank you. Such a pleasure to welcome you here.
Thank you, here. Same to you.
We have our students today with us who are passionate for their careers in creative industries. There are product designers, fashion communication, journalists, and they have a passion and they want to do something in life. And they are here today with us in the audience. So for them, welcome. So what is this Japanese lady doing in Bhubaneswar in India?
Yes, I'm pursuing Orissi dance. 24 years back, I left Tokyo, Japan and shifted to India to learn Orissi dance. So originally, I was not in here in Bhubaneswar in Odisha. I was in the village maybe 74 kilometers away from the Bangalore city. It's called Hesargatta village. There's a dance ashram by Pratima Gauri Bedi, late Pratima Gauri Bedi. And I was there for 5 years to learn. Odissi dance, yoga, and many other things.
Okay. Would you like to share, when did you decide that Odissi is your calling? When did you identify this, that this is your calling, and what choices you had back then against this Odissi dance that you chose to, and choosing India to stay? How did this happen?
I have been learning dance since age 4. I started with modern ballet of Mata Graham. There was a very good teacher who was a friend of my parents, so I started with that. Then I was so much into hip hop dance when I was a high school and university student, but there was no choice of becoming a dancer. Everyone thought, I was going to a Tokyo University or foreign studies, and everyone was busy for getting a job after graduation. So I was also thinking, okay, I will have to take up a job, good job, and work. But during my university time, I had traveled to India, and obviously I wanted to see Indian classical dance in India because I was already doing different kinds of dance, hip-hop, modern dance. I was doing jazz, contemporary, as a hobby. And when I traveled in India, I saw Indian classical dance. Yeah. And I was so mesmerized, and I had never seen such dance. And imagine it is like 24 years back, or rather more back, because I was still a student in university. So, wow. And it was not only the dance, the body movement, but each and every movement was something beyond, something was coming out. It is not just a, right to left movement, but with something was moving. So maybe I saw something so mesmerizing in dance for the first time. Then I decided, okay, I am not taking up any job after my graduation of my university. I'm going to India. That's how I decided. And it was the most craziest decision. But luckily my mother agreed, life is all yours. You do whatever you want to do, but be responsible for your decision. So that's how.
That was quite a courageous decision back then. And especially, I don't know, in 90s, early 90s, what was image of India, and how did your parents, allow you to come? What a courageous decision for your passion. So you followed through that. Could you take us through your journey with Nitya Graham, and how did that life and or the role of Nitya Graham in making of Masako Ono?
I must tell you that when I decided not to take up any job and going into India. See, the India then, like 20, 30 years back, was not India of this today. So when I was traveling to India just for sightseeing and all that, it was as if for me was going on a time machine. And it was very, very shocking. Every scene, whatever happens in India, was a shocking experience for me. And most of the people, yes, my mother was supportive, but most of my relative friends, they thought I am gone mad. And in fact, to take up this kind of peculiar decision was also unconsciously affecting me. My eyelash started to fall. And my eyebrows also became very less number of eyebrows. The hairs were falling a little bit. I think I was unconsciously so much stressed. But I have decided. My mother said, go for it. So I had no choice to look back. But imagine the pressure. And when I reached from the Bangalore city, my dance school had to reach to my dance school. I had to take 2-3 buses, like changing the bus, this and that. And it took, I think, for the first time, it took me almost 4 hours. And when I reached Pratima Gauri Bedi, she was the founder of that dance ashram. And she asked me, what do you want? And I said, I have sent you letters that I would like to learn at your dance school and, you know, try to become a dancer. Then she said, what? Try to become a dancer? Then I got what she wanted me to say. She wanted me to say, I am here to become a professional dancer. So it was also shocking for me, but I was just, very typical Japanese with very, very soft voice. Though I said, I'm here to become a professional dancer. Will you teach me? So that was my answer. And that entrance, that conversation made me, okay, I will do it because I cannot go back. I told goodbye to my family, my friends, and goodbye to my job because I was already, passed in some exam for a very biggest, one of the biggest company. But I said, goodbye, I'm going to be a dancer, Indian classical dancer. So I had no choice. So that entering day really changed my life. So after that, I was like, yes, I will do it. I will make it as a dancer. So that's how my journey started. So I owe everything to this late Pratima Gauri Bedi for making me such a strong person and a dancer. Yes.
Thank you. Masako, any time during this journey, was there a point when you wanted to go back and you wanted to give up and you thought that probably maybe this is not, did you experience that feeling of maybe failure or down that now I'm giving up? Did you go through that and how did you come out of it?
I think yes, of course, every here and there, because as you can see, I look very Japanese. I don't have eyes like Indians. You have such a very big eyes with sculpturesque structure of your face and body. My body structure is like a pencil. So many a times, not only my body structure and face structure, but yes, people are so kind to tell me, Masako, you won't make it because, yes, if your nose were 1 centimeter longer, you could have made it. Or, this kind of comments every here and there I hear. But yes, always when I was in the dance school, when everyone is sleeping, I went to the woods because it was out of nowhere. Like, there was nothing, there was no village even. So I just go out and run into the woods and just cry and scream. But I always remember, no, the founder, Pratima Gauri Bedi, she told me, you have to decide. So no matter what, ever people would tell me, I will make it. So that was my attitude in the end. But obviously, even how much ever the strong your belief, of course, there is a way that, one becomes very not so confident, lose confidence in you. But every time I had to retrieve that confidence. Yes.
Yes, I agree. I mean, it is so important to follow it through. There will be times that we will fall, but we will have gurus like your late Pratima Bedi and your gurus around here who will help you come up around. Thank you, Masako. So, you know, in this journey, I'm sure, like Odissi, it's an Indian dance form and it's storytelling. Dance form is also about storytelling. So I'm sure that you were exposed to a lot of Indian mythology, our epics, our gods and goddesses, and the messages there. Could you share your personal interpretations of maybe some of the excerpts of Indian mythology? And how did you maybe retold those, you know, those stories and maybe some new message for contemporary India through your dance?
So originally I was mesmerized on the mudras, emitting more than the body. So that was mesmerizing. But when I reached this Indian dance ashram, I saw a dance performance of Radha and Krishna. And the teachers told me the story. Masako, you know, in this story, Radha, who is a cohort person is checking when the husband is sleeping, making sure that he's deep in sleep. And she goes in the midnight to meet the true lover, who is Krishna, the god. And Krishna is really also, he's having a lot of women around, so he doesn't come. And she waits, and then she waits, and he never comes. But when he reaches, after maybe some days later, or maybe next day, whenever he wants to reach, he has this marks on the lips, red marks or scratches on the body. And then she says, oh my God, how dare? Then he says, no, it is just on the way, some thorns of the plant or flowers. Oh, this red color is just by the red berry, which was on the way. And then also my teacher told me, they are also in Indian dance, there are four ranks of women. So Radha is Uttamanaika, categorized as Uttamanaika, the top level of woman. So how she really, she responds to his answer is not like, oh, you liar, this and that. No, she just says, go away. That's it. So, you know, like, only this much when my teacher told me, I have learned so many, many things, and also like new concept. True lover is God. God, she has husband, but it's okay to go out because he's a God. And the way she says, go away, instead of just, you know, throwing fights or throwing plates and glass to him. So yeah. All this perception and what is God. So I am not following particular religion till now, but I have a lot of respect. And this mythology taught me many things. And now I have a layer of understanding, like Sanskrit can be also understood in many ways. So now through this mythology, learning mythology through Odissi dance, I am not shocked in one thing, like a very stereotype understanding I don't have anymore. Yeah. I'm able to tackle it in layers.
Yes.
So that's how I think I really owe to Indian classical dance and Indian mythology to make me grow and make make me more interesting person as a person. Yes.
Okay. And would you like to share some memories of maybe some of the best performances that you've had that you're really proud of to share with us?
See, I started to learn dance. After 5 years of staying in the ashram, I shifted to Odisha because I'm kind of graduated from that dance school, and I shifted. And then also I kept on learning from really wonderful gurus and teachers in Odisha. At the same time, after 5 years of learning, I wanted to start to perform. So I started to send my photograph and bio data and try to perform. Because I was for 5 years from morning to night practicing, and also after shifting to Odisha, from morning to night, I practice. without any food even. So whenever I was performing, I got quite good reviews and response, and the people also saw me, oh, she's Japanese, she looks chinky, but she's doing our culture. So Indian people also appreciated. So like that, I had also performed in, I was invited to States, USA for like maybe 15 places I was performing. Some doctor in US was sponsoring. I was very lucky. And all that was there. Also, I performed at the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. Yes. But what made me very much happy was my first solo performance at Kamani Auditorium.
Okay.
That was somehow because Indian dance, and I wanted to perform at Kamani Auditorium in New Delhi. And in fact, ICCL, the Indian government cultural department, they have organized a performance for me. And I was the first person to perform. There were hundreds of media and everything. And after the performance from Japan, I got a call. I saw you on Japan Times. I mean, there's a newspaper in Japan. I mean, my photograph was there. And I have, that was, I think, already like 3 years or 4 years after my graduation from my dance school, because also initially I was very shy. No, I learned dance, but I am looking chinky and I'm not good enough. So I was only aiming to perform in a small festivals that nobody will know that I'm performing. But yes, then some media covered me. Then I already performed in States and this and that. Then I got the invitation at the Kamani Auditorium. That was really, for the first time, I felt, yes, I have come to this point that I can perform and I can say I'm a professional dancer. So that was very, very fulfilling moment for me.
How did your parents react to this when they saw you in newspapers in Japan? Your parents, your family, your friends, who you left them so many years back. Mm. How did they respond?
They were, of course, they were very, very happy to the fact that, yes, I have come to this point. However, as a dancer, it is very, very tough financially. So I remember, in fact, I think my mother came to my performance in New York or in Washington, D.C. And on the way back, because she knows my financial status, and she told me, Masako, you really made me proud. But I still wonder. because I wanted to become an architect a long time before. So if you would have become an architect, you know, so there was a mixture of compliment and mixture of, my God, my daughter, are you going to be okay for the next, you know, so many years from now? So at that moment, now she might have, you know, having different ideas, but that was her response. And also, she never meant that stop it or anything, but I think it was just her honest feeling at the time. Yes.
It does. You know, so many of our students also, they have to fight against family, you know, to pursue a career in creative industry. So many of them want to become photographers, journalists, and parents, rightfully, they ask, how will you make a living out of it? How can you have a successful career? You don't. So it is so important. There are such big names in these creative industries, in dance form, in art forms, in cultural industries, that you are an inspiration to all of them. And I'm so, so thankful to you that, you know, today you are addressing our students on this. Okay, let me come to a question that has, you know, I don't know how will you respond to this, but you know, all Western photographers, media, who have won so many awards also, they showcase India as, you know, for poverty, for problems, for atrocities on women. And they have won awards. And those are the page one stories in international media many a times. So many cases are, you know, shared there. What is your perception of India now that you're here? What is India to you today? And what defines an Indian woman to you?
You know, also I so much relate to this because I was also, I have been very upset with some medias because that rape case which happened in Gurgaon was, yes, it had to be also flashed as a news. That's horrifying news. But when it comes to the ratio of rape case in Japan and India, I don't know if India is higher or lower. I think Japan is higher. And all without all this solid research, media is just talking about the one horrifying incident forever and ever. And, oh no, no, but we should not go to India. I mean, that's stupid. And I think after some years, maybe after 5-6 years, or maybe it will start from in a few years, they will all start to ask me, can you help me, Masako? I want to shift to India. I know that. Anyways, so those photographers and media person, see, they just come in search of some news or shocking, frames. Obviously, they will just take, if they find a dirty car on the street or messy, chaotic roadside and this and that, that is also natural because they have to report that and they know, oh, this is India. I mean, it's just a chaos. But the thing is, they don't know the other side of India because, for example, I'm a woman and in Japan, I, as a university student, even when I was high school student, many Japanese people, they take up a part-time job. And during my university time, I was a receptionist in a very, you know, fancy club where there is also Japanese traditional restaurant and bar, and I was just a receptionist. And I was already feeling male-dominated system in that job already because, yes, when I did not go out with these people who were working with me, who are like double the age of my age, if I say no to them and they would just put the unnecessary pressure on me or they tell lies or Masako is not keeping the cashier, the money properly and they backtalk. I mean, I felt hopeless. And also, that also made me also made me strong. Yes, I will make it as a dancer because I'm not taking up any job. And also, if I would have taken up job, I had to also fight with these kind of people who are so, male dominant and dominant. Their behavior and they are used to it. So I was feeling already very much frustrated with this situation. I don't know now the Japanese, but I think somewhat like that still now. But in India, this was by late Pratima Gauri Bedi who told me on this. Masako, do you know about Durga? In India, every man, they know that woman is stronger. So for me, it doesn't mean like whether woman is stronger or male is stronger. I mean, there is always a role and we are, you know, but we are in the same. It also, it depends in which line and what terms. But that made me really even more strong and confident. Yes, we can do it. And also, she told me that it's from the ancient times. Look at this mythology and Durga and Shakti. So that has been always in my mind. Also, you know, this chakra awareness and female Medha, all the elements are inside us. We have a universe in our body. So that kind of perception of our entire universe and our universe, that is, useful knowledge, which, I mean, it might be a common sense in India, but people outside, they don't know. Yeah. So this, India is so deep, and India teaches us, for me, India teaches me everything, but India teaches many, many things. So, you know, it's just a surface that they are portraying, but we cannot help them and they will live like that. We cannot do anything. So also in my future agenda there, you know, I want to also make more understandable what is Indian way of living, or, you know, I think the world is following India in the end. Yeah. Yoga and, you know, and even like slow lifestyle, India is, I think, ahead of many, many countries. Yes.
How beautifully you put that, really. Yes. In fact, sustainable living comes in India. I mean, today the world is talking about sustainability, but it's India, the Gurukul where you were in Nityagram. What a sustainable living it was. Everything, you know, grooming to everything. Your total development was towards a livelihood which led a sustainable life. What are you doing today to keep up to those ethics and sustainable livelihood? Are you part of this green movement that is around us and sustainability?
Other than dance, we have a foundation called Mudra Foundation. Because, yes, I wanted to show you something. Because when I perform in different countries, they are not only mesmerized by my dance performance, but also the jewelries, if you know, silver jewelries and filigrees. You know, this is also, I want to show. Can you see? This yes. is silver and it's all handmade. So I get to, so many fashion designer, they come to me after the performance. And they say, oh, I want to come and this and that. And in fact, in India, you have so many handmade things from jewelry to, you know, like craft art. And so with Mudra Foundation, we also made this Dokra book.
Oh.
Which, you know, like a tribal woman who are making Dokra and all that we have featured. So that with this book, if anybody wants to come to India and do something with the artisans, and also we have made, also this is called golden grass. And these are also golden grass. This is a key holder attached to the golden grass bag, which I'm using. And, you know, this is also golden grass. And this is also Dokra with bells. You know, people love bells. This is elephant, hathi. So I'm using this. And also, I have some project in Tokyo next year. So people are wanting to buy this. So in Tokyo, in a very fancy department store, we are going to do also, you know, some pop-up shop. And this is also like a party bag with a little bit of ikat. Ikat, you know. Yeah.
Mm. Yes, yes.
And it's a party bag. So these are made by Japanese art, designers. So this kind of amalgamation with the artisans in the village and also those people who are experienced designers. I am not a designer, but I'm here to help them coordinate. And that's what the Mudra Foundation is doing.
Okay, that's wonderful. So as a you know, cultural ambassador to India, I think you have been appointed as a cultural ambassador to India, Japanese cultural ambassador. What are your goals, that what change you want to bring in India or in the Indian dance form or the society that you're living in today? What is that one change that you want to bring about?
See, when I think it's also any country. See, maybe some Indians must be thinking Japanese means they are wearing kimonos. But actually, in Japan or in abroad, people say, oh, India, the cow, auto rickshaw, or rickshaw, Varanasi, yes, 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 they go jump into the river. Oh, everyone is wearing turban. So this kind of also impression is still there. You know, nothing to do only with the country, maybe not only limited in India, but India, it's already new India. I have seen it. It's not the India which I, you know, I knew 24 years back. So my future plan in terms of Indian classical dance. See, I'm a very spiritual person, but I don't incline only towards one religion. That is very clear. But also, I have the right to perform Indian classical dance, even if I am just a particular follower of one god, no. So in terms of dance, I want to share all my experience over 24 years. Also, I have been teaching, but in a very spiritual approach, not religious approach. So that I am doing through my online Zoom class. I have already started Zoom class. And also, you know, first, so it's my responsibility because I learned from a very, very, you know, I mean, really top teachers. And it's my duty to pass it on to generations, younger generations. So that I'm doing also not limited only for Indian people or Japanese. I have students from, you know, different places. So that's number one. And I want to share everything. So I've already started to make also, you know, those teaching, and I'll be also publishing in video, and you can learn everything through video also, or live session, Zoom session. That is one thing. Second of all, I wanted to do Odyssey dance is, I wanted to create new choreography to evoke people to realize that there is also a universe within ourselves.
Yes.
And to make it resonate with the universe, the, you know, big universe. So I keep on creating, not in the boundary of Odyssey dance, because I have been doing and I still want to keep on doing. That is second thing. And the third thing is I would expand my area of contribution to connect with India and Japan for sustainable activities, may it be dance, may it be art, economy, any area, as I was treated with much respect by the Indians, and I would like to give back to give back the respect to both the countries, India and Japan. That is, I think, my main future plans as of now.
Okay.
Yes.
Masako-san, this brings me to many questions that our students are asking in the chat box. So the question is from Megha. She says that, ma'am, I'm also a dancer and I have learned Western and freestyle for 10 years. I can also perform semi-classical dance. I always wanted to grow in dance, but unfortunately could not find the right platform. Then chose fashion design as my career. Your journey is inspiring. I would like you to tell me how and where to start our journey in dance and grow well in the industry in current times.
Okay, so I haven't seen your dance yet. See, now also we have to be very much aware of this current situation with Corona. Okay, so now I have also a project with Japan because I was having a project with Japan during Olympic. The Olympic is postponed, and so our project is also postponed. But I was also talking with those the project teams that let's shift all the project that we are doing because we have to do it. Along with the Olympic, it's a dance project. Everything we are planning now shifting to online.
Yes.
Now you have a lot of possibility. Before, maybe you had to be on TV. That was the only way to be acknowledged. Now you can be online. If you nail it, you nail it online. And so now the chance is tremendous if you're good. The problem of now this current situation is whatever you may be, you put this effect, that effect, if you're not good, nobody will watch. So you have to be aware. If you're real, then the chance is tremendous.
Yes.
Yes. So also you have to be very much updated how to advertise. I mean, I'm telling to myself because I was, zero. Now I also started to upload something on YouTube. I mean, you guys must be knowing everything that I don't know. I would like to learn from you people, actually. So you just go for it. That's it.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. So, Megha, hope it answers your question. Could I invite my colleague Deepti, who is the co-moderator for the session, and take us through some more question and answers here, questions here?
Absolutely. Masako-san, this is just going so good. I think the students are absolutely motivated and inspired. They're posting so many questions here, and I had a lot of questions waiting, parked for you in my email. So I'll be taking one by one. So the first question that I have received in my email account is how costume and aesthetic makeup plays an important role in your dance form?
Yes, I know. Extremely important. However, I became aware of my costume and everything only after maybe 10 years. I had a student after 8 years of my dance, learning and career and everything. She was Italiano. She told me, she used to call me Mashu because I was also quite young that time. Mashu. Costume is very important. Then I look at myself. Yes, Italian knows styling. So from that time, I started to become aware. I tried my best way to do this and that. So I think maybe if you see me, if you Google Masako Ono Orisi, some of my costumes are like quite different. And then so I tried different things, and also like that clicked also many, many fashion designers or artists, and they also recently I had a very talented artist who was residing in Paris who came here and designed for me Odyssey costume, but very, very creative, very important.
Yeah.
But I must tell also another thing, very important, but if you want to be a real artist who don't have to feel like insecure, you know, like if you are only doing nice photo, Instagram and this and that, and if you are zero dancer, maybe you might be successful. People might give likes and shares and everything, but inside you are so busy because, oh, what's next? I have to look this and that. Maybe that might give you a quite difficult time. So if you want to be like, okay, relaxed artist, then first do your dance. Forget about anything, you know. But when it's like a present, when you're presenting your art, yes, it does make a lot of difference. That much I want to tell. But also I want to repeat, I was zero in the beginning because I was busy. Practicing. First, I had to hone my dance. If you're a model, you have to walk out and, you know, be slim. Then only the clothes looks nice. Likewise. So don't make a mistake. What is the, you know, the core? Then, yes, all this, you know, is also very important.
Thank you, Masako-san. My next question is, apart from Orisi, what values, culture from Japan do you share with and teach your students at the Masako Ono Performing Arts Studio? What is the cultural exchange, the fusion of values that a student studying at the MOPA Foundation takes away with him?
Well, see, we have also Odisha Biennale. I'm just showing, you know, this is an art and culture, not culture, art, and also not only dance. It's a festival which we organize in Bhubaneswar every year. And the people from the world are coming. Japanese, Indian, European, and South American, and, you know. So, naturally, they will meet different different people from different parts of the world. And of course, also, because I'm here, so people come to learn from Japan and different places. So I ask them to teach what they do. So I had a hip-hop dancer from Japan, so she was teaching hip-hop dance. I had flamenco dancer learning from me from, she's from Peru, and another one was from America States. So they were teaching flamenco, all that. And yoga teacher was coming from Italy, and one classical ballerina was coming from UK. So that it is like, nothing only limited to Japan, but you can learn everything. If the timing is good for both, you know, if you're here, but also online, I am having one classical ballerina teaching in my online class. She's in Japan. Because I saw her technique is very good, and that will also help in Odyssey dance. So very fundamental classical ballet, really absolute beginners she's teaching. Also, there was a request from my student, little ones, that they want to learn, ma'am, please teach us Japanese. So in some class, I'm teaching 15 minutes before the, you know, before we dance, I'm talking to them and teaching some Japanese. So like that, I am incorporating. So, I mean, yes, you will meet many, many Japanese. And also my class, I have in my Zoom class, especially, I have students from India, Japan, Germany, Russia, United States, Singapore, and all that. So I teach everyone. So by now, in Japanese, migi means right side. Hirari means left side. So all the international students, they know migi, hirari. Ah, now he's telling migi, okay, right side. So naturally, you learn many, many things.
Yes. Right. Kusan, that's so, you know, that's so inspiring that you actually act as a fusion of values and culture, and you know, you're giving so much to both the countries. It really is a pleasure to be talking to you. My next question to you is, Masako-san, your journey has seen many challenges, as you yourself just mentioned, one of which has been securing sponsorship because of your nationality. Initial years, it has been a tough time for you to sell the craft, because the Indian organizations would say that you're not an Indian, and Japanese organization turned you down because they felt that you're not advancing Japanese culture. How did that come along, you know, in your journey? How was that tackled by you at that particular time when it happened?
To be honest, it happens till today. So unfortunately, nothing has changed. But I think I am becoming stronger year by year. Mm-hmm. And yes, also, because I wanted to do everything and I am confident I'll do it. But also it's sometimes nice those to ask people. And also this also I learned from Pratima Gauri Bedi, that she told me, Masako, ask, you might get it.
That's true.
You know? So yes, let's learn. Also, I'm also sometimes have to remind myself, it's okay to ask. And even if they refuse, no feeling. Because I have done my work to ask. Unless you ask, they don't know that you want it. Yes.
Masako, there is, Nia, you want to say something?
Yes. So Deepti, I think there are many questions in the Q&A section also. And these students are so, they want to know how to join online classes for Masako, how to, you know, which Bollywood actor you like. Have you tried Bollywood dancing?
I think let's do a quick rapid fire sort of a thing. Masako-san, one of my students wants to know, have you ever been intrigued with Bollywood dance form? And who is your favorite Bollywood actor?
That is very difficult. I'm so sorry. But I have taught Bollywood dance in Japan quite many times.
Wow. And what were the songs? What were the songs you choreographed?
What was the song which I was teaching in Japan? I'm sorry, I forgot. Like twisting, what is this? Twist.
And to what was it? To twist.
Was it the 1960s song? Was it the 1960s?
No, not so old. I have done, I'm so sorry, I cannot just remember now. But it is, I think, some are available on YouTube, I think. Because here I teach also kids and they said, ma'am, I don't want to do Odyssey today. I want to learn Bollywood. So, okay, I had to, you know, pick up. So I mean, quite good, to be honest, in Bollywood dance. And yes, I like many, many actors and everything in India. But, you know, I think I am more into women because Aishwarya Rai and Padukone, what is the first name? Deepika. Like, I'm one of all these women. Mainly, I'm so sorry. And I am married to an Indian, so he's my icon. I'm not looking at any actors.
Okay, Masago-san, I think we're running out of time and we have a lot of questions. So I'll just quickly take the last two questions now. One question from Disha Mohanty is, there are so many dance forms in India. Why did you only choose Odissi and what keeps you hooked only to this one dance form as a career?
Very, very good thing. Very, very good question. See, every country, I think the ideal art is different. This is what I have heard in New York when I was performing. She saw my dance, and Odissi dance is like Z. You know, Z. It is not equilibrium. It is, you know, different. How do you call it? It's not equal. It is not right and left perfect. No, something.
You're understanding what you're saying, yeah.
You know? And in China, it is equilibrium. Perfect, right and left, up and down. But in Japan, it is not. Japan art is should be always imperfect. So now in Japan, Odissi is the most liked, loved, favorite dance other dance. So somehow Odissi dance from the beginning, I really liked it. And also in Bharatanatyam, Kathak, I love the rhythm of Kathak and Bharatanatyam, like, you know, so many, like Shiva posture, I love it. But somehow it is more subdued Odissi dance. And as you can see also in Bharatanatyam, like when you, even I have done little bit of Bharatanatyam long time back, it's more up-tempo, but Odissi dance is more like this, and you know, right and left, not, I mean, you know, same. So that is, I think, I am mesmerizing, and maybe also partially I'm because I'm Japanese. Yes.
Okay, so I think let's take our last question. I'm just looking at the question answer box. There are more questions now. The next question is, in this modern world where Western influence is increasing so much in a developing country like India, how do you really promote or give prevalence to classical dance and the music forms? I mean, particularly to this generation that's watching you right now.
Odissi dance also I am doing, but from the beginning, Odissi dance was not my goal. At all. Mm-hmm. If you see me on YouTube, also I recently also collaborated with Pete Lockett, who is in UK, who is a percussionist, and also SK Shromo, beatboxer. Okay, that I am just wearing something random and I'm just performing, and you can utilize this Odissi dance. Why I wanted to do this? Because there was nobody who is doing new choreography based out of Odissi dance. There was nobody when I came, you know? So hip hop dancer, also hip hop dance today is different from hip hop dance for 30, 40 years back. We have to evolve, you know? Otherwise art will die. So I am also at it. And also that's why I become also very unique. I'm not using hip hop to do some collaboration. I mean, there are how many? Like thousands, I mean, maybe like, you know, million thousand people doing the same thing.
Right.
You know? I mean, I'm not interested in dive into the red ocean. So you have to be also, you know, I mean, I didn't select because it's not a red ocean. No, I was wanting to do it. So it just happened. But you have to really think twice. If you want to do like engineering, you are diving into the, you know, red ocean. How will you win? You got to be unique. You have to find what you love. Your original, I mean, what you wanting.
What are you passionate about?
Yes, what are you fascinated about? It must be different from mine or Dipti or from Meha. Everyone is different.
Masako-san, one last question and then we wrap up. Any specific advice to a beginner of Indian classical dance to make it big?
Indian classical dance?
I mean, any dance form, any class, like yours, like, you know, like to make a career in Indian classical dance. Is there a specific advice? This is a question from Niharika Chauhan that we have. That's the last question that I see here. So...
Not particularly in Indian classical dance?
No, I mean any classical. Let's take it like that. What's the advice to a beginner? Somebody who's just starting?
Okay, just starting. I'm so sorry to say. You have to fix what time or which day of the week, from what time to what time, you are going to practice, write it down and just repeat doing it. There's no shortcut. I'm so sorry, but that is a real reality. You have to do it. And also, like, you know, why? Because I said set up a time, and, you know, and I would say if you want to be successful, you have to do it every day. There's no other choice. No other choice.
Very well put across. I think there is no other choice. There is no other choice. It's only repeat, revise, practice, practice, practice. And that's what creative industries are for. Even if you are doing your foundation course, students, there is practice of sketches, practice. That's it. That's what makes you a fashion designer. That will what make you a good dancer. So best of luck for that, my students. And Masako, thank you so much for spending this time with us. Thank you so much. Your journey is an inspirational journey. And today we also have in our audience the person who has put together this entire module for the pre-semester learning experience. We have Abhijit Rahut, and he is the person who, you know, conceptualized that what students will learn when they are at pre-semester. We have his dean also here, Ambika Magotra. She's also with us in the audience. And both of them together have put together this wonderful program for our students. And you have been part of this journey with us. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That is my word. Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Deepthi. It has been wonderful today together, all of us. Okay. Do you want to make an announcement?
Looking forward to yet more conversations with Pearl Academy and the students. And this was amazing. Thank you so much.
Namaste.
Thank you.
I have a little announcement to make. I'm meeting the students. I'm the module leader, Deepthi, and we have something very exciting coming up for you next week. And the guest is none other than Raveena Tandon. And, you know, when we listen to her name, when we just hear her name, we're like, Raveena Tandon, the Bollywood actress. But let me tell you, there's a lot more to the name. There's a lot more to this personality. And I am literally telling you to keep your questions parked because you will have a ball of a time. She's coming to you on the 27th, which is a Monday at 11:30 in the morning. So please start sending in your questions at aroundtheworld@ pearlacademy.com, the email ID that you have. You can also check Instagram for your updates and emails. And let's have a good time with Raveena on 27th. So yeah, that's it. Thank you so much. Thank you, Meha. Thank you. This was such a great interaction with Masako-san and you. I think we really had a good time. It was very enriching. And there were so many takeaways from this conversation. I think I'm really excited for the other ones also coming up now. And let's see what we have in store. Okay, bye-bye. See you.